Some of you may or may not know, I spent a number of years ministering in Mackay, and that's the proper Queensland, we used to tell people. And we were called today a two-shirt Sunday. Became a bit of a joke, but that's all right. You go home feeling quite damp and soggy some Sunday mornings after church, and so it became a two-shirt Sunday. Lovely to be with you here once again to share a word and a message, and on behalf of Noel and myself, we really thank you for affirming me as your new pastor for next year. So thank you for that. We look forward to journeying with you, and certainly I do, and as we get to know each other and share God's word and see what he has in store for us for next year. So I just want to say thank you for that. It's a real blessing. Certainly I'm excited about what the future may hold as we journey together with God, and certainly he doesn't let us down. Amen? That's for sure. So welcome. If you're new, if you're visiting, I'll get to know most of your names, hopefully, over the next little while, and certainly in the new year, I'll be here a bit more regularly as well, so that'll be good. So I'm looking forward to that. Today's message is called Relatable, because we all need to be able to relate to one another in our world. We all want our relationships to be healthy and meaningful. But sadly, in this day and age, we've lost the ability, I think, to talk, to listen, to care, to share, to chat. We're very good at texting and posting and tagging and whatever else we can do. But we need to be able to relate well to one another. We need to be able to be growing as men and women, growing in our communication, growing in our service, growing in our care and love for each other. I've got a little video that I want to show you this morning, so hopefully Kim can cue that up and we'll have a look at that. Maybe this happens in your house, I don't know. Slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. Let's just pause and pray this morning. Father God, I pray that as we just take a moment now to consider these thoughts, Lord, help us relate well to each other. Because, Lord Jesus, you relate to us. And you care for us. And let us be those who care and relate well to those around us. Maybe we need to have a conversation around the dinner table. Maybe we need to connect with our neighbours and friends. Maybe we've lost that connection with someone dear to us over time and distance. But in this special season of Christmas, maybe it's time to reconnect. Maybe it's time to relate better to you, Lord God, and then relate better to those around us. Lord, speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God has connected us together. Your parents will always be your parents. Your children will always be your children. Maybe throughout your life you've had work colleagues and business partners. Maybe you've job shared. Maybe at school or at work you had classmates and friends that you needed to relate well in life. Husbands and wives, we need to relate well in our marriages. God wants us to relate well and have meaning growing relationships with each other, whatever the setting. In church, in life, in work, in service, let us relate well to one another. Let us be people of grace and kindness and openness. The question is this. The big idea is this. The degree to which we are able to receive what God has given us and is giving us, to that degree, we are going to be able to have a meaningful relationship with those around us, with people, and fulfilling relationships in everyday life. So how God has blessed me and how God has blessed you, we should then let that then flow on to others. We need to have the ability to receive what God wants to give us, so that we have reflective, effective relationships with Him and with those around us. God wants to do amazing things in my life, in our life. There are two reasons we're not good at receiving from God. Number one, we don't think we are worth it. We don't think we are worthy of what God wants to give us. And we say to God, I know, God, that you're good. I know that you're perfect and loving. But I don't think I'm worthy enough to receive your blessings, to receive your mercy, to receive your grace and forgiveness. God, I don't think I'm worthy enough. Because we know what we like, don't we? So I'm not going to receive what you're trying to give me right now. The second reason we don't want to receive what God has given us is because we've heard another voice in our life that says, well, God, I'm fine. What I have is better than what you want to give, and that is so wrong. God comes to us today with open hands and open hearts, and he says, follow me. Let me fill you with my spirit. Let me love you and shape you and mold you and guide you. Let God come today to us and let us have an open hand and an open heart and say, thank you, Jesus. As this Christmas time approaches, people don't need more lights on their trees and lights on their houses. They need the light of God within their life. And may we be the givers of that light and love as we reach out to people this season. And let us receive His best this time of year. How will we receive what God wants to give us? Will we have an open hand or a closed fist? Jesus is available to all of us. Let us go to Him. Let us believe in Him. Let us follow Him. Throughout the Gospels, we can see a Jesus who went to people. The broken, the forgotten, the struggling, the poor, the rich, the sad. Put the Gospel in the middle of your relationship. Three things to consider this morning. Can Jesus relate to you and me? How does Jesus relate to us? And how will that impact the way I then relate to those around me? How would you describe yourself today? If you could text a phone number and we could have it magically pop up on the screen there, how would you describe yourself today? Maybe you would say, I'm struggling. I'm successful. I'm married. I'm confused. I have questions. I'm single. I'm disconnected. I'm full of faith. I'm scared. I'm hopeful. I'm a child of God. I'm loved. I'm saved by grace. I'm happy. I'm seeing dreams realized. I've got many questions, whatever. How would you describe yourself today? Is Jesus able to relate to you as you walk the roads of life? Yes, He is. In John chapter 1, verse 14, we read, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling amongst us. John 1, 14. We have seen His glory. The glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus came fully man, fully God. He took on human form. He was tempted. He knows temptation. He knows what it is to struggle. And in Hebrews 4:15, we are reminded of this. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. We have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Jesus was patient. We can all do with some of that. Born a baby in Bethlehem. Died at the age of 33. Throughout his life, God's plan is being fulfilled. For the Messiah, Emmanuel, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, died upon a cross at 33 years. As God fulfilled His plan. The Gospels tell us that He was tired and hungry and sad and mistreated and single and alone and angry and frustrated. In the Gospel of John, we have this scene in the temple courts. In the temple courts, He found people selling sheep and doves and other, sitting at tables exchanging money. So He made a whip out of cords and drove them from the temple courts. Both sheep and cattle, He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. What a commotion! What a scene! Jesus wasn't always meek and mild. Don't leave Him in the manger. But receive Him as Savior. He was mistreated. He knew what it was like to have everyone celebrate His name. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And then he knows what it's like for everyone to turn their backs on him and he'll crucify him. Jesus can relate to you and he can relate to me. Upon those mountain tops and upon those valleys and down in those valleys. He went to parties, amen? You awake? It wasn't cucumber sandwiches and just cups of tea. A prostitute came and wiped tears off his feet with her hair. Now that might sound a bit awkward, but it wasn't for Jesus. The people that were broken, the people that others would pass by, the poorest of the poor and the richest of the rich, men and women and children were all welcomed by him, and we are welcome too. Can Jesus relate to me and relate to you? Yes, he can. People, all part of his story. We are all part of his story. He does not give us what we deserve. How does Jesus relate to us? How does God identify and connect with us? We see this in Psalm 103, verses 8 to 14. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, dads, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we were formed. You can count on God. He formed you. He knows you. Jesus can relate to us. He comes all the way from heaven to earth. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our sins. We are given mercy and grace and hope and salvation. Just receive it. Thank you, Jesus. Towards the back of the Bible in 1 John chapter 4, 7 to 11. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Those words might be very familiar, they might be very unfamiliar to you. God so loved us. He has demonstrated this to us. God has given us the free gift of grace and mercy. He's poured out his love upon us. He says, unconditionally, here you go. Have some grace, have some mercy, have some kindness, all for you, all for me. Have some salvation, have some forgiveness given freely. It's endless. But sadly, as we walk these roads of life, at times God gives us so much. But it's like we grab a teaspoon and dispense very sparingly some love, some mercy, some grace, some kindness, some hope. We celebrate all that God has done for us, but we dispense it with a spoon to others. Because we're flawed. Because we've listened to those voices and we think that we aren't worthy to receive what God has given us, and then we don't think we're worthy to give it out. Let us be thankful for what all God has done for us. Let us as Christian men and women be the ones who are there first to care, to help, to love, to show kindness. Let us be thankful for what God has given us. Don't dispense it with a spoon. What we dispense is a reflection of what we have received. Some of us need to accept that God wants to give us so many things with open hands and open hearts. Let us be a giver, not a consumer. Up on the screen there, a slide for you as I finish this morning. Jesus died for you. Jesus died for me. Knowing you might never love him back, that is true love. For God so loved the world. For God so loved the world. His amazing grace. Don't hold back. Let Jesus have his way in your life. Let Jesus have his way in my life. Don't listen to those negative voices. Don't listen to those hurtful words. But shine a light for him this Christmas. May we be his living hope. Pass on what you've received from him. Be reliable. Be relatable as Jesus is reliable and relatable to us. Let our lives reflect that. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.